Let me introduce myself. I'm Alan Shaw, a paleontologist at KLJ. My background is in geology with an emphasis in paleontology. I've worked in a number of public and private sectors throughout my career, with the majority of my experience being in museums and universities, and only recently being hired at KLJ in the private sector. In the last 5 years, I've worked as the Standing Rock Tribal Paleontologist. Okay, first let's pose the question, what can paleontology do for your project? What I want to do in this presentation is provide you with an understanding of what paleontology is, the similarities between archaeology and paleontology, and how paleontology may affect your project. I will briefly discuss the laws and regulations associated with paleontological resources on federal, state, and private lands. I will also describe what I do and how I do it. And finally, I will mention some of the projects utilizing these services and marketing possibilities. At KLJ, we offer complete solutions for your engineering-based projects by partnering both internally and externally to meet the client's needs. We have services, experience, and resources to help clients take their projects forward, meeting the needs and demands of a growing community and nation. While a client may only need one or two immediate components of our solutions, the option is always there to add value to their project by accessing our skills and solutions. Let's dive right in. If you have questions during the presentation, please feel free to type them in and we will answer all of your questions at the end of the presentation. What is paleontology? Simply put, paleontology is the study of ancient life. Paleontological resources are any fossilized remains, traces, or imprints of organisms preserved in or on the Earth's crust that are of scientific interest and that provide information about the history of life on Earth. You can think of paleontology as fossils, fossil remains, that can be separated into two main groups, body fossils and trace fossils. I will explain the difference between these two groups in the next slide. Why are fossils important? Well, fossils provide us with a non-renewable scientific record of the history of life on Earth. Their scientific and educational value depend entirely on how they are collected, stored, and exhibited. So here are a wide variety of fossil types. In the previous slide, I mentioned body and trace fossils. A trace fossil represents what the animal left behind. So you can think of it as skin impressions, footprints, and just like it looks right there, coprolites or fossil feces. These are all traces of what the animal left behind. A body fossil, on the other hand, is the actual remains of the animal, the skeletal elements. Here you can see a representative sample of body fossils from dinosaurs, reptiles, plants, mammals, fish, insects, and shelled organisms. All of these represent various types of fossils. When all of these fossils, we have the various plants and animals, are found in the same location, they tell paleontologists a very unique story. Fossils not only tell us about the animals and plants that may have lived long ago, but they also tell us what the environment and climate were like. Fossils provide a rare window in time, giving us a rare view of ancient ecosystems. I'll come back to why this may be important later, but now we're just going to go right into what the fossils are and what they look like. So let's take a look at some pictures to get a better idea of what fossils are and what they look like. Here you can see a couple of examples of how fossils are found eroded out of a hillside and lying on the ground surface. Over time, these fossils break up into ever smaller pieces until they are ultimately destroyed. So if they are not found when they first start to emerge from the ground, they will likely be destroyed through natural processes within a number of years. The fossils that you're seeing here are small pieces of turtle shell. And when you look at these, you'll notice that there is some texture covering the surface, which makes it much easier to identify them in the field. Often, though, unless one is experienced, fossils appear to be nothing more than rocks. Usually while surveying for paleontological resources, the fossils found will look like broken or scattered surface material. These fossils are turtle shell fragments with pieces of a crocodile vertebra in the photo in the middle. And they illustrate how fossils can vary and can be broken up and laying on the surface. Once they are found and uncovered, they begin to take on the appearance of something that can be recognized. Some small fossils are found intact on the surface, while others require a great deal of work to excavate them. Here you can see a large chunk of petrified wood on the left, still in place and continuing into the hillside. In the middle picture is a single leaf impression with thousands and thousands of other leaf impressions coming out of the same shale outcrop all around it. And finally, on the right, you can see clam and snail shells eroding out of a sandstone. All of these fossils were spotted during a field survey and would require some effort to excavate and protect. The turtle shell pieces and the crocodile vertebrae shown in the previous slide were found on the surface and required very little effort to collect, protect, and transport. So most of the fossils that we find while surveying fall within these two groups and require a very minimal amount of time to document and collect. Not all fossils, though, are like that. They can range from solitary and small, like the croc vert and the turtle shell, to large and occasionally articulated remains. So instead of just a single crocodile vertebra being found, you might come across a partial skeleton with vertebrae, ribs, scutes, and limbs, and maybe even a skull. An articulated specimen like a crocodile skeleton could take hours to days to maybe even weeks to collect, depending on the complexity of the specimen. In these images, petrified wood was eroded out of a hillside nearby, and then the material was washed together and congregated into this one location. On the left is a group of petrified wood consisting of two large stumps and several partial logs. In the middle picture and on the right is a very well-preserved petrified log section, and down there towards the, as you can see, here's the enlarged picture there on the right. You can see where these tree rings are still showing on this very well-preserved log section. So collecting these fossil specimens, and you can notice the size of them, there's a hammer in each of the pictures for scale. So there's a hammer you can see here, as well as the hammer here. The size of these specimens are quite large, and the weight is considerable, which makes collecting these a very, very difficult project. So as we move beyond the fossils, we can talk a little bit about the differences between paleontology and archaeology. And we'll get back to looking at some of the fossils as we go further into the processes of the field survey. But let's talk a little bit about how paleontology is different from archaeology. Because I know that in my own experience, most people find it difficult or don't quite understand what the difference is between the two. This slide is a great illustration, and it presents the differences very easily. So here on the right, human remains and artifacts from human activities are typically found in soils or burials. And on the left, we can see ancient animals often found in stone or rock that are largely extinct. This is the general difference. If we define them a little bit better, we can look at archaeology as one that deals with past human life and activities, while paleontology deals with fossils of plants and animals. Who cares about paleontology? Well, paleontology as a science is much more than just dealing with fossils. Most people think that we just go out and we collect dinosaurs. But as paleontologists, we use fossils to learn more about what the Earth was like in the past and how environments changed over time. Like I mentioned in that previous slide when we were looking at the environmental and climate overview, showing the different dinosaurs and different animals in some kind of a environmental picture, we can get so much more information from fossils than just collecting dinosaurs. Think of the importance of paleontology in this way. Though paleontology seems to be focused on what happened in the past, it can also be used to think about what could happen in the future by studying the many patterns that we can observe today. This kind of brings us to our next question. What does this have to do with my project? Well, if we look at our next slide, we get a little bit more into the rules and regulations, or the laws and regulations, I should say. Are they required and when? So paleontological resources have been managed and protected by a myriad of laws and policies over many years. Two such are the National Environmental Policy Act and the Federal Land Policy and Management Act. Both of these acts have different sections that talk a little bit about paleontology. But the acts in general are largely about cultural resources. More recently and comprehensively, the Paleontological Resources Preservation Act, known as PRRPA, was signed into law in 2009 and directs land managers within the Departments of the Interior and Agriculture to manage and protect fossils using scientific principles and expertise. As you can see here, there is quite a list of requirements. We're not going to get into all of these requirements because the ones that really matter to us and to our projects are the ones that I've highlighted in red. So if we just take a quick look at the ones in red, we can get a better idea of the requirements for any given project that we may have. So our first one there is to manage and protect paleontological resources on federal lands using scientific principles and expertise, and manage how fossils are collected via specific permitting requirements. Well, how is this accomplished? Well, each agency is slightly different in their approach, but all require a qualified paleontologist following professional standards and having an agency permit to survey, protect, and collect fossils. Our next one, curate collected fossils in accordance with the Act's requirements. So only federally approved repositories can be utilized for storage of fossil specimens collected on federal lands. And to meet this requirement, a repository or storage facility must meet federal minimum standards and have a qualified permitted paleontologist secure a repository agreement from an approved repository. And the final one there is to protect information about the nature and specific location of fossils. This is as simple as keeping information that's confidential, confidential. So if there's information about fossils or fossil localities, that information should only be shared with people on the project that need to know that information. Otherwise, the public should not be given this information, and we should continue to try and keep all of our fossil locality information confidential. The Paleontological Resources Preservation Act, or PRRPA, is not entirely new, but acts as a way to bring the various laws and regulations from a multitude of other acts together under the same umbrella to protect fossils and provide consistency between agencies. So you can think of it as, like when we were describing or talking about NEPA, there are small sections throughout a number of acts that discuss paleontology, but none of these acts directly discuss the entirety of paleontological resources or their importance. The Paleontological Resources Preservation Act basically brought all of these little parts of different acts together and put them under the same umbrella. So as of 2015, the Forest Service within the Department of Agriculture finalized its regulations regarding the managing and protection of paleontological resources on Forest Service lands. The land agencies within the Department of the Interior, BLM, the Bureau of Reclamation, Fish and Wildlife Services, and the National Park Service are currently working together to do the same. Even though some of these land agencies have yet to finalize regulations as required by the Act, most of these agencies already have regulations and policies in place to manage and protect paleontological resources. The three main ones, the BLM, Forest Service, and National Park Service, have policies similar to the ones I discussed on the previous slide already in place, and they have been in place for many decades. Well, what does this mean for the future? Well, I've already observed a noticeable increase in projects requiring the assessment, survey, and mitigation of fossil materials. Federal and state agencies in our region and beyond are actively moving in a direction of greater protection and mitigation for paleontological resources on both federal and state land projects. For this reason, it is not only important, but crucial to understand the laws and regulations as well as the processes and methods surrounding these resources. And that kind of brings us to our next topic. How do you protect paleontological resources? Well, the way that we do this is first we look specifically at the geographic location where fossils are found. Geographically, paleo resources or fossils are found in almost all areas of the United States. This map indicates all the places in the United States where fossils have been discovered. Darker dots, or the larger circles, show places that are richer in fossils. Fossils are most often found at or near the surface in areas of exposed outcrop. Rock exposures, like you're seeing here in this image. This is a picture that was taken in the Little Missouri Badlands near, here in North Dakota. There are various other locations similar to this all across the United States where fossils are being found. This brings us to our next part, which is to determine exactly how we go about locating and surveying for fossil material. So what we actually do, and the process is very, very similar in many ways to archaeology. There are three main phases. We have a data analysis or desktop review, a field survey, and construction mitigation. Each of these phases can be determined separately or jointly. So sometimes the data analysis or field survey may have been completed days, weeks, or even years before, and we still need to go ahead and finish the construction mitigation phase. So we would then bid this out and move forwards with the construction mitigation, utilizing the information that we have from the field survey and data analysis phase. So whichever one fits a project, we can do here at KLJ. Each phase is concluded with a report. So in the data analysis, which is also known as a desktop review, this consists of finding information about the project area to determine the likelihood of it impacting paleontological resources. So we do this through satellite reconnaissance, looking at Google Earth, for instance, determining known fossil localities, identifying the geologic units, and reviewing all of the pertinent paleontological and geological literature. For areas that are identified as having a high potential for scientifically significant fossils, a field survey is recommended or required. So this is where it differs from archaeology. Significant fossil specimens found during the field survey or construction mitigation are almost always collected, prepared, identified, and curated. Following the field survey, a report is written describing the results and providing recommendations for protecting paleontological resources during construction. A construction mitigation plan provides a framework to follow during construction. As mentioned before, fossils found during construction are almost always collected. And this may differ depending on the type of fossil that is found. For small fossils, easily collected fossils, a paleontologist will always collect them. But if we get into fossils where it's a large area that's covered, or that there are a multitude of fossils across a given area, it may require the project to be moved rather than to collect every single fossil. So it is largely dependent on the fossils themselves. But towards the end, a final technical report is written detailing the entirety of the process, from data analysis to final mitigation, and including any fossils that have been found. So if we actually move on and take a look at the process, in this case, we're going to look specifically at the field survey. So let's pretend that we have done the data analysis phase, we've done our desktop review, and we've realized that a field survey needs to be done on this particular project. So through applications, like I mentioned before, like Google Earth, we can determine information about a given area just by looking at the satellite reconnaissance. Here on the left, you can see an overhead map view, and on the right, you can see more of a three-dimensional view, both showing kind of these vegetated areas that are lightly green, greenish gray, and then the bedrock exposures that are kind of gray to white. Paleontologists conduct field surveys primarily on areas where bedrock is exposed. And this is also where it differentiates, or it differs from archaeology. Archaeology is looking at areas where people would have inhabited, and that's not usually on rocks. It's usually in forested or grassy areas. And so we look primarily at the rocks, whereas archaeology looks primarily at the grassy areas. Take a look at this outcrop. The photo inset on the right was taken along the base of the outcrop. Notice the dark colored debris scattered down the localized drainage areas on both sides. Similar to these rock pieces, broken pieces of fossil material eroding out of the hillside would congregate within drainages very similar to what you see here. Once fossil material is found, it can be traced upslope to the location where it is eroding from the hillside. In some cases, the majority of the fossils or fossil may yet be within the hill, requiring additional work to collect them. Here's a great example. On the surface, if you take a look at the photo on the left, a bit of shell material was showing right down here by this plant. And as we traced this material up, we were able to identify the location where it was coming out of the rock, right next to my hammer here. If we look at our next image, here you can see what it looks like without anything being done. This is just what it looks like as we see it on the ground. With a bit of work removing the rock around this shell material, an almost complete, and you can see here now that we've removed the rock, an almost complete clamshell was exposed. And this is a great example of what we see on the surface may not be indicative of the entirety of the fossil within the ground itself. So something as small as this clamshell requires a minimal time to expose and collect. Larger fossils, as I mentioned before, needing collection, such as petrified stumps, can take a considerable amount of time to expose, protect, and transport. So let's actually take another example. Let's consider this example right here. So here we have a nice section of outcrop. So while surveying on a project, we came across some turtle material. And if we look here next to this backpack, just upslope, right along this gray area through here, we found a number of pieces of turtle shell that were eroding out of the hillside and cascading down the hill. Here, we have our paleontologist sitting there recording some data. But these little spots that you're seeing right here, they're kind of tan colored, are some of these turtle shell fragments that were seen coming out of the hillside. So here you can see, get a better idea of what those turtle shell fragments look like as we can see them just right there on the surface. More than 50 pieces of shell were collected off the ground surface. So shell fragments were found further down the wash as well as further up the hill, indicating that there may indeed be more material within the hill itself. So we traced the shell fragments up the hillside and we were able to find the location where they were eroding from. It turned out that no additional turtle shell fragments could be located within the hillside and that the turtle shell pieces that were collected were quite heavily eroded. This told us that the fossil material had been probably out on the surface for a very long time, with pieces continuing to break down and get carried away or destroyed by the elements. The turtle shell pieces were documented, collected in a labeled bag, and transported to the lab. Here, you can see the pieces still covered with dirt and debris awaiting cleaning. So after cleaning each piece, they were laid out and the pieces were reassembled where possible. Even after the meticulous collecting, cleaning, and reassembling, enough of the shell was missing with many small pieces unable to be reassembled. You can kind of think of this as a jigsaw puzzle without the picture, only having 50 pieces of a 500 piece puzzle, and the edges of some or most of those pieces being broken off or lost. And so we're kind of left with just a variety of pieces, and it may all be from the same turtle shell, but we're unable to reassemble it into a identifiable shell. Which kind of takes us to the next step. Now that we've done all of this work of collecting, of piecing them together and cleaning them, now we have to identify these pieces. And the way that we do this is we take these turtle pieces to a repository or to a storage facility where they can be compared with similar material from the same geologic units collected from other sites. Here you can see the collected pieces as they compared to the repository pieces. So here are the collected specimens. And then if we throw in some of the specimens from a storage facility, a repository, we can get a good idea of the similarities between these specimens. The comparison resulted in identifying the turtle shell pieces collectively as likely coming from a soft shell turtle. And it was a turtle by the name of Plastominus. Collection, preparation, and identification of fossils are each key parts of protecting paleontological resources. And all three are necessary for the compliance and mitigation of paleo resources found on both state and federal land projects. So now that we've talked a little bit about the many different parts of paleontological resources, from what paleontology is, to the laws and regulations, and even to the process, I'm going to talk a little bit about the projects and more about the way that we go about marketing these resources. So in the past, KLJ projects requiring paleontological resource services were often subcontracted out. But as of March of 2016, these services have now been added to the many other environmental services provided by KLJ. The first project to utilize KLJ Paleo Resource Services was on US Highway 85. And this was a North Dakota DOT 62-mile road project that included areas within the Little Missouri Badlands. So as seen in this image, there were areas that required very little or no surveying. And these are the areas that are largely green with trees close to the road. And then there were areas that required extensive surveying. And these were also all of the areas that were the badlands or the outcrops, the rocks that were close to the road. So as we look at different projects, each project is completely different in the way that we go about the process of whether or not we need to do a data analysis, a fossil field survey, or even construction mitigation. Another project requiring a paleontological assessment was the Dickinson Theodore Roosevelt Regional Airport Expansion Project. Each project is different, and some may only need an assessment or desktop review to determine if paleontological resources will be impacted, while others, like the Highway 85 project, with the expansion of the road, may require not only a field survey, but additional construction mitigation. We work on all types of projects, from roads and pipelines to airports and well pads. Here at KLJ, we're taking a proactive approach both internally and externally. Nobody wants to be in the middle of a project only to find out that it is being held up because it is in non-compliance or the project will need to be moved. So understanding what paleontological resources are is key to providing this information. And this is information that is not only new to you, but was initially new to KLJ as well. And so when I was hired on as the KLJ paleontologist, I began by providing educational instruction to KLJ as well as to some of the clients that we have working with KLJ. Because we want to not only provide an understanding of what paleontological resources are, but how to properly manage and protect them on federal and state lands within any given project area. So internally, I am providing information to KLJ staff and clients about paleontology and fossil resources. This occurs through a variety of processes or formats, such as providing presentations, PowerPoints, coffee talks, newsletters, email correspondence with project and technical area managers, as well as calling and meeting with KLJ staff to assist in providing this information to them and to their clients. This kind of brings us to the question, why? Well, we're doing this in an effort to determine how we can best protect non-renewable paleo resources, we can remain in compliance with federal and state agencies, and we can provide timely and efficient services to all of our clients. So if we look at our approach externally, there are also a number of key things that we focus on. The first one is identifying and pursuing projects that specifically need paleontology services. So if you have a telecommunications project, we would look at service lines and pads for towers. If it was a oil and gas project, we would focus on well pads and pipelines. For transportation, it would be road expansion and new construction. Secondly, working with KLJ staff, we want to preemptively determine if there is a need for paleontology services and then to provide that information to the project client in the early stages of a project. Finally, we want to acquire consulting permits and we want to be added to the various consulting and contractor lists. Some federal and state agencies, the BLM for instance, will authorize regional and state consulting permits to qualified paleontologists on a yearly basis specifically for consulting work on projects. I recently acquired BLM consulting permits for various states throughout the region. With these permits, I can effectively consult on any client project on BLM land anywhere within these states. Additionally, listings of BLM permitted paleontologists are also kept by the BLM, and other agencies have similar lists, and these lists can be provided to project clients as needed. Finally, identifying and implementing other applications for paleontology and experience that we have here at KLJ. For instance, instead of surveying on a well pad project, a Native American tribe wants to survey and inventory the paleo resources on reservation tribal lands, or collect and document the fossil specimens that have already been found. Having worked with Standing Rock as their tribal paleontologist before, this would be a great project and a worthwhile one for not only KLJ, but for the tribe itself. And finally, as you can see here, my last point is input. And my final point, input. Your input is key, whether you are an industry, company, agency, or a current prospective client. I would love to receive any kind of feedback that you have, because this will only make the services that we provide that much better for our clients. I am currently working with the marketing team here at KLJ to create, develop, and implement both internal and external marketing strategies based on this proactive approach. Because you never know when it's going to happen. fossils are found on your project. Nobody wants to find fossils on their project, but it almost always happens. And as you can tell by this slide, the guy on the right must be a paleontologist. He's way too happy in having found fossils. Fossils, these are fossils that were recently found during construction in China on the left and California on the right. And it shows, it's a perfect slide for showing that no matter what kind of a project it is, fossils have the potential to show up. Whether they are like on the left with those wonderful dinosaur eggs in China or the mammoth stuff that's found there on the right. So thank you for joining us today. I hope you all enjoyed the presentation and have a better grasp on what paleontology can do for you and your projects. If you have any paleontology or engineering needs, please contact us at the number above. We offer a variety of services that range from transportation to building design to telecommunications needs. So for more information about KLJ and our services, please visit our website at kljeng.com. I will now take any questions from anyone that has them. So if you are unable to stay for the duration of the Q&A or have questions specific to a project, please feel free to contact me directly and I'll do everything possible to answer those questions. Thank you.